it has been a long 8 weeks. As of yesterday, I am 8 weeks post-op my myomectomy surgery. And I just want to say it was a complete success. So for all of the women that have left comments on my previous videos that I did about me preparing for this surgery, I want to let you know that I have read your comments and I try to respond. If I haven't read them, I will eventually read them and respond or like your comment, because I know that this is something that I think the statistically 70 to 80% of women will have fibroids. So the majority of us are going to have to deal with this at some point in our lives. And I just want to let you know that my surgery was life-changing. And now I'm just going to tell you and give you some feedback about what happened, what I went through, how the recovery was, and all that type of stuff. Because I know when I was preparing to go for this, I wish that there was a video like this. I wish that I could have sat down and watched a video and literally heard from the person who went through it, how it was, and what they recommend and what they don't recommend and all that type of stuff. So we're gonna hop right into this and I'm gonna try to give you all the deets so that you will be prepared for what's to come. Now, this is just in my opinion, do with it as you want. Don't take this as medical advice. This is just, I'm sharing my experiences with you. Okay, the first thing I want to do is I want to show you guys a picture. I'm going to pop a picture up and I want to show you a picture of my fibroids. So my doctor ended up removing 11 fibroids in total. These are some of the biggest ones you see in this picture right now. Essentially, my uterus was so big that it was coming up to my diaphragm. And as you know, your uterus is supposed to be like this big. Mine was like, my doctor said my uterus was the size of someone carrying a 6-month baby. Like, it was a massive uterus. Like, my diaphragm was pushed up. It was hard for me to breathe a lot of the times. I could actually touch my stomach and feel the fibroids. They were massively huge. It was a whole situation. So, to get all these babies out was definitely an improvement. I can now breathe. I don't feel like my diaphragm's pressing up on me. I don't feel like, you know, I don't feel anything when I touch my stomach. It's soft. It's wonderful. I have a flat stomach again. I'm also going to show you my before and after picture. So essentially, this is what my stomach looked like before I had the surgery. It was very distended. It was sticking out. People are now questioning me saying, how did you hide this? Because if you look at any of my pictures or my videos from before the surgery, you wouldn't have known I had all of that going on down there. Now, this is the picture of me after the surgery. You can tell my stomach is significantly smaller and I'm still very swollen in my stomach, so it's going to get even smaller than it currently is previous right now. So I am very excited about that. Just going from, for so many years I've walked around with this huge stomach looking like I'm pregnant, to now having a regular flat stomach. I can wear what I want to wear. My self-esteem has shot through the roof. Like, I feel so much better and I look so much better. Like, that alone is literally life-changing for me. Like, I am just excited about what is to come. Now, I'm a member of quite a few, not quite a few actually, but two different Facebook groups that are for women who are going to have like the myomectomy surgery or hysterectomies, and it's for women with fibroids and things like that. I actually will link a couple of them below so that if you are going through this, I think that those are great resource groups that you can ask questions in and you can kind of vent to, because I definitely did it. You can like go to those groups and type in my name and you'll see all the posts that I made over, because I had so many questions. But one of the questions that everyone wants to know is, what do you bring to the hospital? So within those groups, they have these long lists of all these things you're supposed to buy and bring and all that type of stuff. Let me tell you, I didn't need all that. There was literally 4 things that I had to have and that I recommend you have too while you're in the hospital. The very first thing are slippers or whatever you like to walk around with on your feet. Now, of course, the hospital will give you those slipper socks. However, I don't like slipper socks. I actually like slippers because I like the hardness of a slipper at the bottom. Because you're going to have to do a lot of walking. My doctor made me get up within the first few hours of my surgery. They made me walk up and down the hallways multiple times a day. You know, you're walking to the bathroom. You have to do a lot of walking while you're there. So you want to make sure that you bring some slippers so that you can walk around, especially in the hallways and stuff. I wouldn't want to walk around in socks. So that's why I always recommend slippers. The next thing that I brought that is very helpful was I brought an extension cord. So when you're lying in the hospital bed, all of the outlets are behind you. So in order for you like to charge your cell phone, or if you want to plug in a laptop or something like that, it's best if you have an extension cord. So the extension cord can reach, and then you can have the other end, you know, in your bed, and you can plug things in that way. And it gives you room to move around and you don't feel so constricted. So I definitely think an extension cord that you attach your cell phone charger to is absolutely necessary. And then the next thing that I recommend are earplugs. So I am a light sleeper, and in the hospital, you know, things happen 24 hours a day. Even though they try to keep it quiet after like 10 o'clock or so, it's still people going up and down hallways. It's still people opening and closing doors. It's still noise. You know what I mean? And so I knew that when I wanted to sleep, I wanted to sleep. So I would put in my earplugs and I heard nothing. Guys, and these are basic earplugs that I got from like CVS. Basic set of earplugs, but they worked wonders and they allowed me to hear nothing. The nurses would come into my room to like give me medications, and they would have to like shake me awake because I couldn't hear when they were telling me to wake up. In addition to that, I brought an eye mask, one of those blackout eye masks. I have a very simple one that I actually got for free when I went to like an event. No, I actually got these when I ordered my sheets for my bed. They threw in like a sleeping mask with that. And that is what I used while I was in the hospital to block out all the light. Now you're going to be in a room, so you can of course turn the lights off, but still when they're opening and closing doors, and then it's just a lot happening in hospitals. So I wore my sleeping mask, I wore my earplugs, and I slept soundly. Every time I took a nap or I went to sleep, I slept wonderfully with those things. So that is what I recommend that you bring. And in addition, a robe. When you're walking up and down the hallways, because you have to, you know, get things moving and you have to get your exercise in, I always put on my bathrobe. So instead, if you don't have a bathrobe, then you'll have to just wear like the hospital robe. But you know, the hospital robe is open in the back. It's a whole situation. So I personally liked my fuzzy wuzzy bathrobe that, and I actually ordered one off of Amazon that I'll link below for you guys, because it is the softest. I'm telling you, the softest bathrobe I have ever owned in my life. Like, I used to put it on in the hospital. I would put it on in the morning time and just be wrapped up in it, you know, and like cozy all day long, because I love that bathrobe. So essentially, those are five things that I recommend that you take to the hospital. Let's talk about pain levels, because I don't like pain at all. And I actually, that was my number one concern. How much pain am I going to be in? So my doctor actually gave me a pain pump, an IV pain pump, so that whenever I felt the pain, I could push the pump and it would automatically deliver the medications into my vein. That was very helpful because it, you know, gives you some control in case you start to feel the pain, you know, kick in. However, my nurses also had orders for oral pain medications. They had orders for 800 milligrams of ibuprofen, also for Percocet because I'm allergic to Norco. And they also had a muscle relaxant. So those were the three oral medications I could have. So what we did was, at my very first day being there, I talked to my nurses and I told them that I wanted my pain medications around the clock because I did not want this pain to kick in. We agreed that it was better to stay ahead of the pain than trying to catch up with the pain. You understand what I mean? So I still had my pump and I would use it, but they would come in every 6 hours and give me oral pain medication so that I could stay at a zero level pain. Even though it wasn't necessarily zero, it would range between, I would say, like 2 to a 6, depending upon where we were. And if the pain started to get above like a 5, I will tell the nurse it's time to give me something else because the pain started to creep back up. What I noticed for me that worked the best were the muscle relaxants. Whenever I got a muscle relaxant, it just relaxed everything, like all the contractions and stuff I was feeling, like they just went away. So with the pain pump, with the oral medications, I had all of that under control. I do want to say to people out there, you know, I am a registered nurse. I've worked in the hospital. I've been a nurse for over for almost 2 decades now. That's crazy. Okay, that's a side thought. But don't be scared to come up with plans like I'm telling you about with your healthcare providers. Let them know what you're expecting so that they can tell you what they can do for you. So I let them know the very first day, I don't want pain. I want my medications. Don't make me have to call and ask for them. Just bring them around the clock. And that is exactly what my nurses did. It would be 3 o'clock in the morning and they would be tapping me on my shoulder, handing me a pill because I didn't want to feel the pain, and I made it very clear to all of my healthcare providers, I didn't want to feel the pain, so we were all on the same track. What I've noticed when I was a nurse working in the hospital, some people are scared to say that to their doctors. Like, they're scared to say, I want something different, or this medication isn't working. You have to be your own advocate, and you have to speak up and let them know what works for you, because they see so many people come in and out. What works for one person will likely not work for you. And you have to be your own advocate and tell them, because you know yourself the best. And that's exactly what I did. I was very vocal and I told them what I needed, what I didn't need, and how I wanted my stay in the hospital to go. Now, speaking of stays in the hospital, my doctor told me that I would be in the hospital for 2 days. She because I was having an open myomectomy where they cut you open, she was like, you have to be in there for 2 days because we want to make sure you don't have bleeding, you know, all that type of stuff. We want to control your pain and, you know, make sure everything's good to go. In order for me to leave the hospital, I had to have 2 things checked off. One was my pain had to be under control, and 2, I had to pass gas. I had the pain under control because I was getting round-the-clock pain medications. However, I could not pass gas. Because I was getting so much pain medications, I literally was, my GI tract was asleep. It was like dead. Not dead, but it was just like numb. I couldn't feel anything moving in my stomach. I was constipated. I couldn't go to the bathroom. It was a huge situation. Really, it was my only negative issue I had from the surgery was I couldn't pass gas and I couldn't go to the bathroom. Like, have a bowel movement, go to the bathroom. Those are my 2 issues. So when the second day came and I still hadn't passed gas, my doctor was like, well, I can't let you go home until you pass gas. But at that point, I had to be an advocate for myself. And I explained that it wasn't going to happen while I was in the hospital. Like, I was like, I'm not gonna have bowel movement here. I probably won't pass gas here. It's not gonna happen no matter what y'all do, no matter how much Gasix they gave me and all that type of stuff, Miralax. They were giving me all of that stuff. I was like, it's not gonna happen. I need to go home where I'm comfortable, where I can relax and really just be in my own environment. And then my doctor finally agreed. So I actually got out of there on the morning of the 3rd day because I did not want to spend the night for a 3rd night. And I also think because I am a nurse maybe and I'm very vocal and I tell my doctor what I want, she felt confident that if something was really wrong, I would be calling her, which, you know, I would. So she allowed me to go home. But you can anticipate really staying there for 2 days and just making sure that you try to pass gas. For me, they had me walk up and down the halls a lot, but that didn't work. They gave me Miralax. That didn't work. They were giving me gas at X. That didn't work. Like, they were trying all type of stuff and nothing worked for me. Now, speaking of that, since we're on this topic, I'm just going to let you know, since that was my main issue that I had, it took me 10 days to have a bowel movement. Just imagine being constipated for 10 days. That was the most uncomfortable I was when I got home. It was horrible. It was literally horrible. And when I say we tried everything, or I tried everything, I tried everything from enemas to suppositories to prune juice to butter in prune juice to Miralax to Metamucil to whatever you can imagine. It got to the point to where my doctor was had prescribed prescription grade laxatives for me because I couldn't go. Luckily though, I didn't have to end up taking the prescription grade laxatives because what ended up happening was I started to wean off my pain medications. As my pain medications weaned off, my stomach, you know, GI tract started waking back up and I could actually start to feel things again. And then I was finally able to go. But it took a while. It wasn't until the pain medication started to leave my system that my GI tract like woke back up. And then following that 10 days, it still took a couple more weeks for me to get back to quote unquote my normal bowel movement that I had before the surgery. Now I know this is very graphic, but this is what happened to me, so I'm letting you know it could possibly happen to you. It was simply just medication induced constipation. The medication, all of the drugs, the narcotics, it just slowed my system down to like a halt. And once I got rid of all of those medications out of my system, I returned to normal. So if this happens to you, don't freak out. Like I was freaking out. I was starting to freak out. By like the 7th day, I was starting to freak out. By the 10th day, I was like, oh my God, I'm never going to go again. It was a whole thing. Let's talk a little bit about my incision. So with my myomectomy, I had an open myomectomy with a horizontal bikini cut. So it's the same type of incision that you get when you have a C-section. It's really low down underneath like the line of your underwear, so like you can't see it. But in addition, my surgeon told me that I would not have a scar, and I didn't know how that was possible because I've had surgeries before and they scarred horribly. And she was like, you won't have a scar with my surgeon, with her being the surgeon. So fast forward to 8 weeks later, I don't really have a scar. It's amazing. So what she did was she actually closed up the inside using dissolvable sutures, but the outside where the skin comes together, she used glue. It's a surgical glue that literally glues your skin together. And all it does is over time, the glue flakes off. And it just falls off like when you shower. You're not supposed to peel it off or pick it off. Just let it fall off naturally, which I did. It took a couple weeks for all of the glue to kind of fall off. But then once the glue fell off, my skin was just, it was normal. It was pretty amazing. Like, I don't know. Like, I was like, wow. I think every surgeon should use the glue that my surgeon used to glue my skin back together. It was literally It was perfect. I don't have a scar. It's great. Now, what I do have is underneath my belly button and down to the area of the scar is probably this much space. Within that space, I'm still numb. It's 8 weeks later and I can touch it. Like, I can kind of feel me touching it, but it's still numb and it's still swollen in that small area right there. My doctor says sometimes that can take months and months to go away before you get your feelings back, before the nerves, you know, reconnect and regenerate and you can get all your feeling back. And then as far as the swelling, she said that can take months. And for some people, they end up with a pouch down there. And I'm praying I don't have a pouch. So what I have been doing, what I did once I got home, I started wearing compression garments. My doctor did not recommend an abdominal binder for me. However, because I have had previous surgeries, I had a couple of actual surgical grade compression garments that are meant to be worn after surgery to reduce swelling. That is their only purpose. And I will try to link a couple of the ones that I have down below if you're interested in them. They are expensive, but their purpose is to reduce the swelling. And you may say, well, Lolita, can I just go buy some Spanx, or can I just, you know, buy like a little waist trainer off Amazon? No, you cannot, because surgical grade compression garments are literally made differently. They have multiple layers of fabric that do different things. The way that they're stitched and cut is so that it conforms to your bodies in specific ways. The way the area where they put the compression is very specific. I actually, in addition to using the compression garment I use compression foam. I would put the foam, I would cut the foam about this big where so that it would fit right over where my incision was. I would put that against my skin and then I would put the compression garment over that, and those two layers put together was perfect. I think that that is why my stomach went so flat, because I was using the compression garments. So you wanna make sure you check that out. But swelling is just part of the process. The other thing that I used frequently while I was at home, I probably used it almost all day, every day, was a heating pad. Guys, the heating pad for me is so, like, it just makes you just relax and it just makes you just feel like, okay, this is gonna be okay. So I would put a heating pad over my abdomen area and I would just lay in bed with it just over the abdomen area, and it would just relax me into bed. It would just relax, you know, my tension, and just, it would just make me feel so much better. I actually asked for a heating pad while we were in the hospital, but the hospital policy, they don't give out heating pads because they say someone burnt themselves on one, so now they don't give them out anymore. So I wasn't allowed to use my heating pad in the hospital, but the moment I got home, I plugged that heating pad in and I put it over my stomach. Now, you're probably supposed to only use a heating pad for like 10 minutes at a time and then take it off and then put it back. I just literally laid it there and I would watch TV with it because it felt so good. And I will link also below the heating pad that I used while I was at home. It's nothing fancy, but it literally just helped me relax to a different level. The other thing that I used a lot in the hospital and when I got home were multiple pillows. When I was in the hospital, I had 4 pillows on my bed, in that little hospital bed, because what I did was, of course you have one behind your head, but I would have one behind my back, so that whenever I would, because you can't sleep on your stomach, and I'm normally a stomach sleeper, and you really don't want to sleep on your side because it just wasn't comfortable. So what I did was I had a pillow behind my bed and I had 2 pillows on each side of me. And so if I rolled over to one side, I would scoot that pillow behind my back and it was kind of like a wedge. So I was kind of diagonally laying in bed. And then if I rolled over to the other side, I would push that pillow behind my back and it would act like a wedge. And then the last pillow I had in between my knees, because since you're kind of wedged up on your, you know, you're kind of like wedged up on your side, I just put the last 4th pillow in between my knees to kind of keep everything aligned. And that is how I slept in the hospital, and that is how I slept when I got home, with 4 pillows. I literally slept with those 4 pillows for a good 6 weeks. That was how I slept for 6 weeks. Lastly, I want to talk a little bit about the recovery time, because everyone wants to know, how long should you take off for work? You know, when can you wear regular clothes and all that type of stuff? So, for me, I had major brain fog. I'm talking about brain fog to a whole different level. Like, I am one of those people who normally I multitask. I'm always thinking about 20 different things at one time. I'm always writing notes. Like, I always have an idea. I always have something I want to do. With this, my brain was like at zero. Like, I couldn't think about anything. Like, I would literally sit there and try to think about stuff, and it was just, I was so spacey. And of course, it was all that medication I was on, but I was just spacey, spacey, spacey. It wasn't until about the 3rd week where the brain fog started to lift, because once again, around that 3rd week is when I started to wean off the pain medications. So then it started to lift. But even after that 3 weeks, I would say it took another full week for me to actually get back to quote unquote regular. Around the 4th week, I was like, okay, now I feel like I could actually pull out my computer and write an email and not be worried about what the email was gonna say. So I would say, if you work from home, give yourself a solid 4 weeks before you even attempt to like work from home. Now, if you are on your feet and you have to actually be up doing stuff, like if your job is where you gotta like do stuff, walk around, you need to give yourself 6 weeks. For real, for real. 5 weeks minimum. But 6 weeks, I felt normal at 6 weeks. But 5 weeks, I was still kind of like, So if you need to get up and you need to move, you have to go do things at your job or at school or whatever you're doing, take off for 6 weeks. If you work from home, you can take off from 4 weeks. That is my recommendation to everyone out there. Now let's talk about what to wear, okay? Because a lot of people want to know, when can I wear different clothing? When can I wear jeans? So for me, I was literally at home the entire time. The first 4 weeks, I didn't go anywhere. I didn't drive anywhere. I didn't do anything. So I just had pajamas on for that entire time. At 4 weeks, I started to leave the house. That's when I drove for the first time, was at 4 weeks. And I wore loose fitting clothes because I was still really swollen. So, you know, dresses you could slip on, stuff like that. And then also, around that time, I was still wearing my compression garment. So that helped significantly. The very first time that I went out the house, this is a true story, kind of crazy, but the very first time I went out the house just to walk around, I went to Home Goods because I enjoy Home Goods. So, and I could spend hours just walking around that place looking at different things. So I just put on a dress, went to Home Goods, walked around for an hour, and I was in so much pain. I felt like my core strength was like gone. Like standing up straight, I had to literally think about it. And by the time that I left Home Goods, my back was on fire. It wasn't my incision or, you know, my surgery site. It was my back because my muscles were just so weak. So after that experience, I knew that I needed to wear my compression garments when I left the house. So because the compression garments hold everything together and really gives you that support that you need. And so after that, I started wearing the compression garments every time I left the house. And because I'm wearing the compression garments, I was able to wear jeans. I was able to wear shorts. I was able to wear, you know, clothes that fit tighter because the compression garment was already holding me in. So I didn't have to worry about my clothes rubbing up against anything or about any type of support. So to answer everyone's questions out there, when can you wear regular clothes? I think it's dependent upon each and every person, but I definitely say around the 4 week mark, you can probably start to wear, you know, dresses and loose fitting clothes. Around the 6 week mark is when I stopped wearing my compression garment and I just started wearing regular clothes again. Okay, lastly, let's talk about if you need help or not. Now, I'm one of those independent women. I'm like, I don't need anybody help to do anything. Once I get home, I'll just, you know, order some takeout or something. I'll be fine. Like, that was my whole thought process. So here's what I think. I think as far as getting dressed, you will be able to get dressed yourself. You will be able to take a shower yourself. You will be able to walk yourself. You will be able to do those basic everyday type of activities, the basic ones yourself. However, you are going to get tired really, really quickly. Like, I just remember being just, I just felt so much fatigue. Like, all I wanted to do was lay in bed and sleep. Like, I didn't have the energy to get up and do housework or house type of things. So if you have a lot of things going on in your house that need to be done on a daily basis, you're gonna need someone else to do those type of things because you're just not gonna have the energy or the desire or the mental capacity, in my case, to actually want to go and do those type of things. Now, as far as cooking and eating and stuff like that, I don't think that I would have wanted to stand up in the kitchen and cook a meal. That is something I do not recommend that you do, at least for the first like 3 weeks. It's just too much. So if you have someone bring you food or someone make you food, or even if you order delivery, then yes, you can be at home by yourself and just have the food brought into you, then that's absolutely fine. But if you need your meals made either by you or by somebody else, then that is something to consider, because I don't think you're going to want to be cooking and standing in the kitchen and doing dishes and all that type of stuff at least for 3 or 4 weeks. So just know that. But the basic things like getting yourself together, you won't need assistance with getting yourself together, but you will need assistance with household chores and also driving. You're not supposed to drive when you're on pain medication. So if there are places you need to go, then you're gonna need somebody to drive you. So those are things to consider. Driving is a no-no. Standing up too long and doing a lot of housework is a no-no. You're not supposed to lift anything within the first 4 weeks. So doing laundry is a no-no. You know, all of those type of things are no-nos. You're not supposed to be changing beds, and you're not supposed to be getting groceries. You're not supposed to be doing all of that stuff during the first 4 weeks or so. So yes, you could possibly be at home 100% by yourself. If you have assistance, like with people bringing you food or people doing your laundry, then that's absolutely fine. But if you do have people around you, just delegate all of that stuff. You know, just tell them y'all need to do this for the next 6 weeks and just let them do it. So I think that I have covered everything. That this is a long video because I kind of talked a lot in this video. I hope that it was helpful to anyone out there who's prepping for this surgery, to the people who are going to be helping the people who have the surgery. I hope you watch this video too. If you have any additional comments or questions, drop them down below. And of course, I will read all my comments and I will try to answer all of the questions. In addition, make sure you look at the list of supplies that I've mentioned throughout this video. I've tagged and linked everything I possibly could down below, so you can go through there and just click whatever you feel like you want to purchase. And some of the links are affiliate links, not all of them, but some of them I get like a tiny commission, like literally like 50 cents or a dollar if you use my links. So I greatly appreciate it. And that's all. I'll talk to you guys soon.